I've spoken with Bonnie, I've spoken with Rick in great detail, Robin McMillan, there's others that have been involved in Bob and in Bob's life. Now, Bob suffered with, he was diabetic, you know, for years and years and years, and he had been going steadily downhill. There were times that he could barely get out of his room to come and minister. He'd have to wear gloves because of the arthritis and the blood condition. He was cold all the time, and he did hear. His bones were brittle. And so in February, you know, early February, Bob broke his leg. His bones were so brittle, he literally standing on his leg, his bones snapped. And that's what put him into the hospital. He was on dialysis, his functions were shutting down, his organs were shutting down, and he was in Charlotte. And now it had been snowing in February, early 2014. Bob is in the hospital. And again, Rick is coming in to Bob and to talk with Bob on the 12th and the 13th and the day of the 13th, and they're there in the room, and Bob is slipping in and out of consciousness. Bonnie is there the whole time. Rick is, you know, Rick would be in the room, Robin McMillan, others, and Bob would be slipping in and out of consciousness, and he would wake up and he'd say, "Oh, make sure you tell this person this. Make sure you tell this person this, and make sure." And Rick was like, "Cut it out, Bob. Just stop it now. Look, you don't have to keep going on. You don't let go, Bob. You've run the race, you know. You did excellent, Bob. You ran the race. Just let go. You can go now, Bob. You don't have to." And I really believe Bob was hanging on for us. He hung on a lot longer than he probably would have hung on, but he was hanging on for us. And he felt like he was a pop, and that's what real pops do. Make sure you tell this person this. Make sure you tell this person this. And do this.
Like
this.
Jacob.
Yeah. He was hanging on. And Rick said, "Just let go, Bob. You don't have to hang on anymore." And Rick said, big smile came on his face. And he would go under again. He was passing out and slipping in and out of consciousness. And he would wake up and he'd say, Bonnie. And Bonnie said that he would reach up and wipe his face, you know. And he would pat her face. And this was on the late afternoon of the 14th, of the 13th, and so now it had been snowing. The hospital administrator of this hospital, you know, when it snows in North Carolina, you know, everything shuts down, right? Just like it does in Tennessee, everything shuts down. If a dusting comes, man, they run out of the grocery store, runs out of milk and bread, you know, just the way it is. So, but this hospital administrator, it had been snowing in Charlotte. His job was to make sure that the hospital was fully staffed, so he was picking up nurses and doctors and making sure that everybody got there on time to make sure that the patients were taken care of. For days this was going on. He was exhausted. On the night of the 14th, now he knew that Bob Jones was in the hospital. This is important.
He's a believer.
He was a believer, but he did not like the prophets.
Did you know this guy later? Did you meet him later?
No, I've not met him yet, but I feel like I know him. You know, he's really connected with Rick. But nonetheless, he worked for another organization. He worked for Jim Baker. And a bunch of stuff happened there, and he had gotten disgruntled and, you know, he got hurt. And but now he's the hospital administrator, and he knew that Bob Jones was there, and he was probably going to die. He knew the condition of Bob Jones. And he said, if Bob Jones was down that wing, he stayed out of that wing. You know, he just didn't want anything to do with the prophets. He was afraid of them. Well, he'd been running hospital staff around for days. He's exhausted. So now it's midnight on the 13th. And he decides, I'm going to go into my office, which has a keypad. And there's a little office in his office is in there. There's a couch. And he lays down on the couch. He's going to sleep a little bit. And he had just laid down on the couch.
And so this is like 6 hours before Bob was pronounced.
Yeah. This was midnight.
Yeah.
He lays down on the couch, and the door is locked. Everything's taken care of. He's going to sleep for a little bit. And he just laid down on the couch, and he hears, and he's thinking, who is that? There's only one other person that knows that code, and it's the assistant. And the door opens up, and it's Bob Jones.
Wow.
And he's jumping. And it's Bob Jones in his hospital.
Yeah.
In his hospital gown. He's jumping. He's leaping. He's singing. Prophesying. Bob Jones. And Don's thinking, man, Bob really made a comeback. You know? And he's prophesying, and he's, you know, he's singing, and he's dancing, and he's moving around inside the office.
And he still was recovering from a broken leg.
Well, we'll get to that. And so he's prophesying, and he says, Don, you need to write some things down. And so now Don, Bob's got the hospital administrator playing secretary. So he's sitting down at his desk, and he's saying, make sure you tell this person this and tell this person this. And he turns to Don, and he said, and Don, you need to forgive. You've been hurt by so-and-so, and you need to forgive. The Lord wants you to forgive. Don't carry that around in your life. You need to forgive. You need to let that go. You need to love this person and just let this go. And Bob spent time ministering to Don. And Don's thinking, I don't even like this guy. You know, and who do you think you are? You know, telling me. And Bob was telling him, you need to forgive. You need to love. You need to let that go. It's not right to carry it. It's you need to let those things go and forgive those offenses. So Bob spent time ministering to Don. And he said, now, Don, you need to write these things down. Make sure you tell this person this and tell this person this.
And there were many of the leaders in his life.
Many leaders and different people that Bob had relationship with. Okay? Hey, Bill, have you got that slide ready? Don't put it up yet. I'll tell you when. So at this point, Don is taking notes. And Don notices that Bob has blood on his forearm. Now listen to me. Notices Bob's got some blood on his forearm, so he takes a Kleenex and he approaches Bob and says, Bob, I'm going to wipe the blood off of your arm. And Bob says this. Bob says, do not touch me. Don't touch me. He said, if you touch me, you will die. He said, I have not changed yet. Then he said, Don, you must do this and tell this and say this and say this and say this. And he wrote a bunch of other things down. And then Bob left the room and he fell asleep on the couch. And Don fell asleep on the couch. And at 7 o'clock in the morning, the assistant came in and opened the door and said, oh, by the way, Bob Jones passed away at 6:22 this morning. And he's thinking, Bob passed away at 6:22 this morning. I was with him. He didn't say anything to her. He said, I was with him for 2 hours last night. And he went down to Bob's room, and they were just wheeling him out, his body covered on a gurney. And he's thinking, what just happened? And he goes back to his office, he sits down, and he looks at the pad that he has, and he starts reading the pad, and it gets to this point. Go ahead and put that up there, Bill. And it gets to this point, and he's reading this part. If you touch me, you will die. This is Don's handwriting. I have not changed. Don, you, and then it turns into this code that nobody can decipher. That's Don's handwriting. And Don's looking at that on the desk, and he's going, what is this? And he had no idea he didn't write that. But that's what came out. Now, this was 2014. For years, nobody really knew, put that back up, nobody really knew what this was. Some thought, well, it's some kind of a shorthand. Some thought something else. Nobody really could decipher it. And nobody was really, going after it to try to figure it out. But we figured this what this is. This is actually an ancient form of Aramaic. It's ancient Aramaic. This is ancient Aramaic. And I shared this last week at a church with the pastor was a Syrian last week, and he looked at it and he said, that's Aramaic. He said, but it's a dialect that I don't quite understand. He was Aramaic. He was Assyrian. He understood. He said, I see aspects of it that are Assyrian. It's ancient Aramaic. It was a lost dialect. And I'm going to tell you what it says in a nutshell. Don went back and he's looking at this. He's looking at this and it's like, that's my handwriting, but he didn't do that. Don didn't say anything for a long time. And then he finally brought it to Rick Joyner and said, Rick, you need to understand what happened. Now, listen to me. Listen to me. I talked with Bonnie. Bonnie said, the hours on 2014, between 12 and the time that he died at 6:22, he said, Bob was slipping out, in and out of consciousness. He never got out of his bed. He had a broken leg. He couldn't move. He never left. He was there. I was there when he passed at 6:22. So my initial thought was, well, then who was this that hit the code, opened the door, and came running and jumping and prophesying? It was Bob Jones. Don said, listen, I wasn't dreaming. This was not a dream. This happened. I mean, Bob was running around the room. The shadows, he was creating shadows. This was not a dream. He was floating. I mean, all kinds of stuff was happening. And Don said, I was not asleep. This was not a dream. So my thoughts are instantly, then who was this? Bob was in his bed, but this was Bob. So was that Bob Jones? Yep. Nope. Who was that? Was it Jesus?
Jesus.
Nope. Yep.
Yeah.
Bob Jones. There was a time years ago where I was in two places at one time. You were there, James. You were part of that.
Well, we were, Michael and I was ministering at a conference in Ohio. I actually see Jeff, and I verbally welcomed him to the gathering. And my daughter, Grace Ann, sees you and you help her at the registration desk.
But I wasn't there.
Right.
I was prophesying and laying hands on hundreds of people, people that I know, but it wasn't me. I was supposed to be there that night, but it wasn't me. Rick Joyner was there. You were there. Patricia King was there. Paul Keith Davis was there. I was in two places at one time. Now, I don't want to get into all the details of what happened, but it was me, but it wasn't me. But it was me, but it wasn't me. I welcomed him publicly to the conference. I said, hey, here's my good friend Jeff Jansen. Let's go welcome him. I did
my
that.
My God.
Wow. But it wasn't me.
And you were actually in a different city.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
You were actually in a different city.
I was in Nashville, Tennessee at another meeting. Yeah. I was here. So when it finally came out that, hey, you know, the host pastors came to me that night on the Friday night where I finally, James just got done ministering. They said, Jeff, we saw you come in last night. I said, I wasn't here last night. Like I told you, I couldn't be here on Thursday night. I was in Nashville. They said, no, you were here last night. I said, no, I was not. He said, we addressed you publicly. He said, don't come on. Stop pulling our leg. I said, no, I was not here last night. I ministered to hundreds of people, laid hands on them, prophesied. And finally, now, I had people calling Bob, trying to figure out, you know, what was going on with Jeff Jansen. What, and people are saying, oh, you even said, oh, your angel looks better than you. you did say that. Your angel looks better than you. And I just left because it's like, I'm out of here. And I left Saturday afternoon.
That's true, you did, you left.
Yeah, I know.
I left because I got tired. People were calling me a liar. I'm like, listen, well, not you, I told the pastors, I'm leaving, I'm out of here, I don't know what happened, I'm out of here. They were calling my wife, calling Jan, interrogating her, calling her, and like, you know, was he really in Nashville Thursday night, you know, because he was here on Thursday night in Cincinnati, you know, interrogating, angry, mad, spitting demons. Man. So I left and I got to Cincinnati and I said, I know what I'm going to do. I had a flip phone. I'm going to call Bob Jones. That's what I'm going to do. I'm going to call Bob Jones. I called Bob Jones and it rang 5-6 times and Bob picks up and says, yeah, hello. You know? I said, hey, Bob, Jeff Chance. And he said, really? Is really you? Is this your angel?
Oh my God!
I said, oh my gosh! I said, they called you? He said, yeah.
Bob and I were in agreement.
I said, they called you? He said, yep. He said, Bob, he said, tell me, what do you think happened? I said, Bob, I have no idea. I was not there. I was in Nashville Thursday night, but I was in Cincinnati. I said, well, I think it was my angel. He said, nope, that's not it. He said, these things used to happen to me in the 1980s. He said, Viola and I, he was married to Viola then before she passed. He said, we would show up in a city. He told me, so we would show up in a city and a day early. And we would get to, the pastor would say, hey, Bob and Viola showed up a day early. Let's go to the restaurant, let's have lunch. And Bob said, Viola and I would sit around and we would tell them everything that God was getting ready to do in the region. Bob said, and then on Friday or the next day, Viola and I would show up. And we would go out to lunch again. And we would listen to what the people that looked like us said to the pastors and the leaders the day before. And Bob said, you better tell those people to pay close attention to what the person, the man that looked like you, said to them. I said, Bob, I don't understand. He said, Jeff, you need to understand, they must really trust you and believe you to be a prophet. And I said, they do, because I brought a word about the second burning bush, that it would come right down to Cincinnati the second term, that Florida was the swing state, but pray for Ohio. And it came right down to Cincinnati, Ohio, that elected the conservative Catholics, that elected the president for the second term, the burning bush. He said, they do trust me to be a prophet. I went around all the states saying, pray for Ohio, pray for Ohio. Ohio's a swing state. It's going to elect the second term, the burning bush. And it came right down to that. I said, Bob, they do trust me to be a prophet. He said, sometimes your older brother will take the face of a trusted friend and he will go before and tell everything he's getting ready to do.
Yeah.
He said, remember the two on the road to Emmaus?
Glory.
After the crucifixion, Jesus, and after the resurrection, Jesus caught up to the two on the road to Emmaus. And he said, hey, friends,
yeah.
Who? What are you talking about? And they said, they looked at Jesus and they said, are you a stranger in town? Have you not heard? These were disciples. Have you not heard about Jesus? Have you not heard about the crucifixion? Because he appeared to them in another form. So I'm thinking about this. Luke 24. Who was that showed up in the hospital room with Don? Bob was in bed with a broken leg, slipping in and out of consciousness. But here he is standing in front of Don prophesying, talking to him about his life. And prophesying, giving a final word and a final message, not just to people, but to the corporate body of Christ. Do not touch me. If you touch me, you will die. I have not changed yet. But, Don, you must go tell. And it goes on to, this is a final message for you and for me. And I'm going to tell you what that means.
So you got this translated.
Yes.
Now, who translated this?
There was a group of 12, but the person that translated was actually Michael Fickus. Michael works with Rick Joyner. And I don't want to get into the details of how it all happened, but I'm going to tell you what the code says, all right?
So they translate that from an ancient script.
Ancient Aramaic, yeah. And this is what it says, quite frankly, in a nutshell. Remember, he was going to wipe the blood off. He said, don't touch me. You know, that reminds me of Jesus at the garden with Mary.
Yeah.
She saw him and said, Rabboni! And she reached out to touch him. He said, don't touch me.
Yeah, yeah.
Don't touch me. I've not yet ascended with blood. Don't touch me. You know, who was that? Well, I believe it was the Lord. And the message, this is the message. Don, in the face of a friend, a trusted friend. Don, it says, you must consult with the prophets of God. Who can be trusted? The holders of light, those with holy fear. The ones who will become the stewards of what still remains on my shelf. Well, in other words, he was going, but there were still things that needed to be fulfilled. He's not going to fulfill them, but they're still on his shelf. That's us. Those are holy prophets. And not just holy prophet sons, but a holy prophetic company of people.
Yeah.
He was a pop. And this is the Lord speaking. It's the Lord speaking. It's Bob, but it's the Lord speaking. It says, you must consult with prophets of God who can be trusted. The holders of the light. Those with holy fear. For these are the ones who will become the stewards of what still remains on my shelf. And then he says this, I will be careful because I'm going soon. So I will be limited in what I can say here. From a sun, the Lord rests in, and a glorious radiance will be seen on him like a mist or a vapor from my own hand. Yes, monitors will get hot and fiery because of the great displays of the glory. But until the Lord moves, he's talking about revival, reformation, the nations being one. But until the Lord moves in this way, until the succession, experience and knowledge of the fire will continue to grow.
Amen.
And that's the period. That's the end cap. That's in totality what was hidden in that script. Now, I believe that that's for holy prophets with fear, those that are sons that still are the stewards of what remains on Bob's shelf. So it's you and me and others and that are sons that were connected with Bob. But it's also, there are rings, there are spheres. It's a new company. Remember now, three prophets that have gone. They were all Kansas City prophets. Bob, 2014. On 2:14, Elijah, Kings 2:14, a double portion. He went into the ground on 2:22. John Paul Jackson, 2015, died. He went into the ground on 2:22. Paul Kane, the summation of his life. John Paul Jackson was all about dreams and visions and mysteries, dream interpretation, dream language. Bob was the lover seer. Paul Kane passed on the anniversary of the latter day rain, the outpouring, latter day rain, February the 12th, 1948, February the 12th, 2019, 71 years to the day. He was a latter day rain prophet. Luke 4:18 was his key. I don't want to get into that right now. He went into the ground on 2:22. And here's another one. Martin Luther.
Reformer.
The Reformer.
500 years
was
ago.
Buried on February the 22nd. You can't make this stuff up. The Lord is saying something. It's the glory of God to conceal a matter, but it's the glory of kings to search it out. These went as seeds in the ground. What's coming, what I believe the Lord was saying through a trusted Papa Prophet friend to our generation and to generations to come is there is going to be a summation.
Yeah.
There's going to be a consummation, and a son will be on him and in him, and you will be the stewards of what still remains on my shelf. It's about a corporate prophetic company of sons that just don't function in a word of knowledge. They function in the spirit of knowledge.
Yes.
It's not just in a gift of prophecy, but you are prophecy. You function in the spirit of. And this bride, this mature company of prophets, function in the spirit and the power of Elijah.
I receive it.
That's what I believe he was saying. And consummation of the fires, these fiery hot monitors. Ooh. What's a monitor?
Glory.
We will steward something. Yeah. We're the three major prophets that have gone into the ground, each carrying something specific and crazy, are going to come up with seeds of a whole new breed of prophets.
I receive it.
Bill, can you get that? I see stadiums. We're going to end this session with this prophecy. We produced this back about, 98, 99. And some have put pictures to it. This is the open vision that Paul Kane saw hundreds of times with his eyes. And I want you to listen to it. Real loud. A little louder, Bill.
I saw that all of the great stadiums and all of the football fields and auditoriums all of the country were just filled with people seeking God. And it seemed as though in this one place I was allowed to be an observer. There were men like we see here tonight, people like we see just all over this giant platform. And they had stretchers, hospital gurneys, and they had cots with bodies on them, people sick, invalids. I tell you, the invalid section wasn't back in some old tent adjacent to the big tent where nobody could see them like in the old days. but they were all out there before the people. All of these people are walking around, and over the loudspeaker comes words like this, and I heard it just as clear as I'm hearing my voice now, much clearer. We have a resurrection. We have a resurrection. This man was in the county hospital, and he was pronounced dead this morning at 11 o'clock. We have a resurrection. He's come back to life. And then you just see people rejoicing, magnifying God, and it was just like a heavenly symphony. Everybody was just all making the most beautiful, harmonious worship. And then another declaration, we have a resurrection over here. This person had been dead and they rose from the dead, and then cripples and paralytics would be healed and step out of wheelchairs. And people, rather than going wild and giving some, you know, great ovation, their voices would just come up as a great orchestration. I remember I would just seemingly know that God had a string ensemble. He had a brass section. He had all the full piece orchestra and the voices of these people. And it was a beautiful symphony. It was a beautiful symphony of life, thrilling me to life. And so as they were worshiping, then that would die down. And then other paralytics would get up and walk, and other signs and wonders would occur before the vast multitudes there. And this would be going on all over the world. And then I found myself in front of a television set. And when I turned the dial on, the very first thing I began to hear was a news anchor man saying, and this would be on ABC, CBS, and NBC and CNN, all of the major networks, I believe, will carry a story like this one day. And they were saying, ladies and gentlemen, the news anchorman, ladies and gentlemen, we have no news to report tonight. Only good news, seemingly. We just have good news tonight. And there are no sporting events to announce because all of the sports fields and all of the coliseums are filled with multitudes of people. And you'll never believe what's happening. Perhaps you will, but there are resurrections from the dead. Paralytics are walking out of wheelchairs and dropping special devices, and there's all kinds of healings and miracles, and it seems as though they're falling on their face in these stadiums. They're falling on their face and worshiping God. They're singing all these choruses, folks, we don't know who these people are. They're almost faceless people. And I tell you, that is really thrilling, because God is going to have a people that will be so much like Jesus, you can't see them for the presence. And the presence of God is there. So it says, it seemed like the whole world is falling on their faces saying, Jesus is Lord. Jesus is Lord. And it's here, there, and everywhere. All stadiums are filled around the world, seemingly. And the world is turning to God. Listen, friends, the church is going to become that first line of defense again. You hold that and remember,